You're back with Now and Then on OKR FM.
So you do a total search to look at who owned those properties. story behind that. And that was intriguing because we couldn't find his passage to Australia. However, we've narrowed it down to 1879. But he came to Australia having married his aunt. Now, he was Canadian born, and his uncle, John Robertson, was a captain, a seafaring captain. And he and his wife Mary had about six children. And then in 1879, Mary separated from her husband John, was living in Canada, and then married said that her husband was dead, and he and she, Robert and Mary, came to Australia, settled in the land area over near Ballarat, where he ran a sawmilling operation there. She died 2 years later, and then he remarried another Mary, and then they had another six children. Could be more than six, but anyway, so that mystery, Captain John, and the relationship between his aunt, we have no idea. But that did shock us because we couldn't understand how that could occur. Now, whether it was by a marriage of convenience, whether she just wanted to escape her circumstances, whether he was tired of her and wanted her to move on himself, he remarried. He married a 20-year-old when he was in his 70s. So, it was a bit of a shock.
Yeah. And what about something? Has there been something that has stopped you and gone, oh my gosh, we wouldn't even know where to begin to look?
The Daryl Mill has stopped the Railway Research Society for something like 30 odd years. They could never find the location of it. However, following the bushfires of 2009, they were able to get LIDAR imagery, satellite imagery of the ground, which takes out the vegetation from the image of the surface of the ground, and then you can see in man-made formations. And this mill site showed up, and so we were able to go and visit that mill site. It's still yet to be recorded because we had COVID and various other things happen. But we're hoping to bring to light a bit more of that history. Now, that was owned by Abraham Hill from Guildford around 1874-75, and Robertson acquired it either by leasing it or buying it in the 1880s. A lot of money into redeveloping it, and it burnt down in 1889. So it's been lost since 1889. So that's stopped us.
Yeah, that sounds like it would be.
It's a great project. Yes, so that's something we're going to look forward to.
So with things like this, do they quite often end up in like the locations like what we've come with today?
Yes, it will eventually. At the moment, it's a bit controversial in that the Comet Mill is registered, and that's on our disappointment. However, the way in which that site has been mismanaged, bike riders going through there, so people destroying the vegetation, it's not respected. And if we were to bring the Daryl Mill to light, it may suffer the same consequence.
Yeah.
Now, that would be a shame. However, we would like to see it fully recorded and put on the heritage register if possible, if not on the inventory.
That's so good.
say, the Tarawa nation were the owners of the land there, and then the European settlement. So mainly focusing again on Robertson and his activities.
And is there any haunts in the area that you know of?
As in ghosts or
haunts?
Haunts as in locations. No ghosts that I know of. There has been a murder in the early 1800s that I don't think was ever solved. In terms of haunts, there are missing locations such as the early shale oil enterprise, the bats for the cyanide works are missing. Of those. There was eucalyptus oil distillery in Dry Creek Road somewhere. So there are lots of problems still to be solved.
So it's like one big jigsaw puzzle.
It is, yes. And we're just a small part of exposing some of that.
And how often does the Wandong History Group meet?
Generally, once a month, the committee meet. And decisions in terms of upcoming activities such as Anzac Day, which is our next focus. So we have a memorial that is dedicated to over 170 servicemen and women, which for over 100 years we didn't have a memorial like the other towns. So the Governor of Victoria, Vice Chairman, opened that up for us, and since we conduct our Anzac Day services in the Memorial Park, and we get anywhere between 100 and 200 people coming along. It's at 12 noon. We're going to have a sausage sizzle after the service. It's dedicated to commemorating the 50-year service of veterans in Vietnam this year, and we'll have Vietnam veterans service, as well as supported by the Wandong State School. The primary school children are there helping us to conduct the service,
which is fantastic.
Yes.
So, for the listeners out there that might be thinking, I really have something to contribute to the group as a volunteer, or I have a piece of history running around my house that maybe the Wandong History Group could use.
Yes, well. Welcome one and all. Anyone that wants to volunteer, we have something for you. You don't have to be on the committee. You can help us with displays, with artistic work, with writing stories. We would welcome anyone that's got a great writing skill to be able to use our collection and write some material for our website. And other than that, if you've got items that belong to the Australian Season Timber Company, it could have the initials AST on it. We would welcome the opportunity of being able to see it, or if you want to donate it, we'd welcome that as well. We only have one thing that has those initials on it, and that's a coat rack, and on the reverse side is the AST. So, a little piece of lost history.
Yeah, absolutely. So, if you're listening, that's something to give you some alarm bells going off in your head. Yeah, definitely contact the Wandong History Group as well, I say.
Yes, we'd love to hear from anyone.
Yeah, and they do have a website. You can find them at Wandong Heathcote Junction History.com.au, and you'll also find them across Google. You can just type in Wandong History Group into Google. Volunteers really
was located there for a number of years until the residents of Wandong decided that as the town was beginning to grow, there was a post office and there was a general store. The residents gathered together and decided that maybe now, with the location of a woodside and the North East Railway and extension, that the focus for a town should be around the Wandong area, not a couple of kilometres down the road. So they relocated the school to Wandong, and that helped to secure employment for people in the district, and they were happy then to come to Wandong, locate their children at the school. But aside from that, we had the Mount Disappointment Comet Mill School, and that was erected in around 1887, catering to the workers in the forest, of which there were about 300 people living in the forest. There were two streets dedicated to the married quarters, so they had about 30 or 40 timber homes, and the woodcutters, their wives, their children, all lived on the mountain. And they came down for provisions and what have you, but generally they were located on the mountain, and all the services were there for them. So there was a bakery and a butcher and a veterinarian. There were four sawmills. There was a tram line that went between Wandong and the mountain, and sometimes the travelling down the tram line was a bit hazardous because occasionally the engine would run off the tracks or the horses would fall off the bridge. So it was a hazardous environment. So the fact that they had a school there helped, but it was pretty dilapidated apparently. The boards would open up, and so they tried keeping the cold out with hessian drapes on the walls. And some days there was snow and children couldn't travel to school even though they only lived in the immediate vicinity. So that's a little bit of a history about our schools, and we've taken it up until about 2009. So we're hoping that the school itself might continue the story after we've finished, basically.
Yeah, it's important for the listeners that might be wanting to see something that's on display. Does the history group have like displays throughout the years at different locations? Or?
So previously we've operated our events out of the public hall. We generally attract about 100 people to our annual history event.
That's brilliant.
It is, and we had the Walk Through the Wars exhibition, which was staged in the Memorial Park over 5 days in a tent because we didn't have anything else, and we had over 500 people come through. So our exhibitions are quite well attended, and we hold one every year. As far as the church goes, when they are able to present temporary displays, which we have got one on our war history at the moment, and also we have the framed images of the Comet Mill and some of the Wandong images, and people can go on a Tuesday if they would like to see it. No charge, but we're always keen to have donations if people would like to make a donation.
Absolutely. And where is the location?
So, 11 Dyke Creek Crescent, Wandong. The Roman Catholic Church, St. Michael's Catholic Church. We've got huge concrete barrier signs up front that depict Wandong History Group. I'm going to be adding the junction to that. And that's through the kind generosity of Ken Bunch, who has given us those barriers. It just protects the church from the school park, so that they don't back onto the fabric of the church. But also we have a container for storage, and that's been designed as a little cottage. So if you come up, you can have a look at the murals that have been painted on that.
And what are the times on Tuesday for the listeners that want to come and have a
browse? 10 till
So that's Lynne Dore from the Wandong History Group. Remember, you too can get involved. It's all very easy. You can go to the Wandong Heathcote Junction History.com.au. That's the Wandong Heathcote Junction History.com.au. Or you can email Wandong History Group, number 4, with the figure 4, at gmail.com. So that's Wandong History Group, and the figure 4, at gmail.com.
Every Saturday, right here on OKRFM, your feature artist of the week, your what's on TV, your gig guide, your birthdays, who does it better? Matt's top 5 new releases of the week, double plays, flashbacks, and so much more. Every Saturday from 4 p.m. here on OKRFM. You're back with Now and Then on OKRFM.
To restore, but we do have the ability That's right. So you do a title search to look at who owned those properties. It helps if they haven't been too many people owning that property. One case in point is the Wandong Coffee Palace and Railway Restaurant. Now, that has only had, I think, three or four owners. Its entire history, it was a bakery.
Since you've been in Berlin, what's one of the things that has most probably shocked you the most about the history?
In terms of our history,